English. There will be a similar lecture in Russian, which I will record pretty soon. But I want to do this lecture in English just to try how it sounds in English. In this lecture, Walt will talk about the Haskalah, the Jewish Enlightenment. And what is more important, we will talk about the development of Haskalah in Russia and its role in Russian language and Russian literature and the development of Russian Jewish literature and Yiddish Jewish literature in Russian Empire in the 19th century. We'll also speak about the influence of Haskalah on Jewish art, and we'll start to discuss it through the European art of the 18th century, and then we'll gradually show how this art developed in Russia in later, actually 19th century. So the Haskalah, known as Jewish Enlightenment, was an intellectual movement that started in Europe and lasted from approximately 1770s to the 1880s in Russia, actually probably as close as the beginning of the 20th century. And before we go to Russia, I want to talk a little bit about the European background because it's important. The Haskalah was inspired by the European 18th century Enlightenment, but also has a distinct Jewish character. The word Haskalah comes from the Hebrew word sehel, which means reason or intellect, and very much like secular Enlightenment, the movement was based on rationality. It encouraged Jews to study secular subjects, to learn both European and Hebrew languages, and to enter fields such as agriculture, crafts, arts, and scientists. The followers of the Haskalah Maskilim tried to assimilate into European society in dress, language, manners, and also, what is important, loyalty to the ruling power. The Haskalah eventually influenced the creation of both the Reform and the Zionist movements because it believed in the development of religion and adoption is from what adoption of it to modern times, but also because of its belief that Jews should move away from Yiddish and shtetl back to their origins and to Hebrew language as a modern language. It actually influenced very much the movement of Zionism. As early as in the 1740s, many German Jews, and actually some individual Polish and Lithuanian Jews, had a desire for secular education. Some of the elite members of Jewish society knew European languages. Court Jews were protected by the rules and acted as did everyone else in society, their speech, manners, and awareness of Russian language and ideas. As you can see, we mostly speak here about the rich Jews, the so-called court Jews, that actually were quite popular in Germany and Austria. The lower class was also exposed to the outside world. Jewish peddlers interacted frequently with non-Jews, especially again in Germany and in Austria. And during the general enlightenment, also many rich Jewish women began to frequent non-Jewish salons and also started to campaign for emancipation. But again, mostly we talk here about Germany and Austria, much more than we speak about Poland. We also need to talk that actually in the 18th century, Judaism itself survived through very large crisis, which was the crisis of the pogroms of Bogdan Khmelnytsky that led on one hand to the development of Hasidism and Jewish mystical sects, which happened mostly in Poland and in contemporary Ukraine, but also in the sect of Jacob Frank that developed in contemporary Czechia, in Bohemia, and the members of Jacob Frank sect that very much actually were considered as heretics by Hasidic Jews had very strong contacts with non-Jews. Eventually, many of the followers of Jewish sect of Jacob Frank actually decided to convert to Christianity. In the first half of the 18th century, even untraditional German scholars and leaders, for example, such as this very famous Dr. Tobias Moses Kohn, the author of the very famous 18th century Kabbalistic medical manuscript, Maasei Tivya, appreciated secular culture. The Haskalah began in Galicia, which is mostly Germany and Central Europe, and later spread to Eastern Europe, to Poland and Lithuania, and the other provinces of the Pale of Settlement. The Haskalah very much was characterized by a scientific approach to religion, in which secular culture and philosophy became a central value. And it's interesting that it was influenced by Jewish approach, Maimonidean approach, that valued secular studies and used reason as the measure of all things. And in this sense, it very much was opposed to Hasidism, that believed that personal emotion and mystical feeling is much more important than reason. Moses Mendelssohn is considered the father of Haskalah. He was a philosopher whose ideas stemmed from the general Enlightenment, and very often Moses Mendelssohn now is considered the father of Reform Judaism. One of the biggest important issues in Haskalah was the education. The Maskilim tried to remove Talmud from a central position in Jewish education. They included Jewish studies in their curricular, but emphasized secular knowledge, modern languages, and practical training in labor in order to help the Jews become integrated into society. They advocated the study of Jewish history and ancient Hebrew as a way to revive a national Jewish consciousness. They wanted to train Jewish children in common sense, tolerance, and reason. The goals of the Maskilim very much were affected by absolutist rulers of the time. For example, Joseph II issued one typical edict for all Jews of Bohemia, Moravia, and Hungary in 1780s. He decreed that Jews must establish normal school or send their children to state schools. Jews were allowed to attend general secondary education schools and university. Marriage was prohibited without certificate of school attendance, and anyone who studied Talmud before completing the school curriculum could be even imprisoned. And the result of this decree, many new modern Jewish schools were created, especially in Bohemia, Moravia, and Austria. The first Haskalah school was founded in Berlin in 1778 and was called the Youth Education School, Chinuch Nyarim. It was a free educational school designed for poor children, and the curriculum included German, French, arithmetic, geography, history, art, some Bible studies, and Hebrew. The school was very successful. It began with 70 students, but in a few years actually grew to 500. Talmud was absolutely completely abandoned, and in this school, both Hebrew and general studies were taught. And such Haskalah school is later developed in Dessau and in Frankfurt, and Jewish educators became to write textbook to guide this new Jewish curricula. Haskalah also brought change to the education of girls, because usually girls didn't study in yeshivas and didn't study Talmud, but Haskalah, starting from 1719, started to create the school for poor girls in Germany and in Bohemia, and the curriculum generally included Hebrew, German, fundamentals of religion and ethics, prayers and arithmetic. Only few schools, and mostly in Poland, also taught Yiddish, usually as Yiddish writing and reading, handiwork, art, and singing. The Haskalah affected education in other European countries besides Germany, and very slowly from Galicia it moved through Poland to Russia. The very first school similar to ones that I just described opened in Lvov in 1845. Lvov actually was one of the cities in the contemporary I would call it Russian Empire. Yes, Ukraine now is not part of Russia, but let's call it traditional Russian Empire. It was before the revolution. Lviv actually was one of the cities that mostly, probably, and highest, like at the highest level, was affected by masculine education. The second such city was Kiev, and then we'll talk about Odessa. The school in Lviv opened in 1845, and then in the 1820s and 1830s, quite a few other schools opened in Russia, especially in the large cities, and the, in the not in the shtetls, but in the large cities in the Pale of Settlements. And these schools were oriented not towards poor folk, but rather towards rich Jews of Kiev, later Odessa. There were no Jewish secondary schools in Russia, and those who wanted to continue their studies went to non-Jewish institutions. In Russia, as the hope of emancipation grew, the number of Jewish children studying in secondary education schools increased from 2,045 in 1870 to 800 is in 1880, despite the so-called percentage norm that Jews had to overcome then they wanted to get to secondary high schools, such as gymnasiums. And usually it was the children of the Jewish intelligentsia or rich Jews who were able to pass the very rigid exams and get into the non-Jewish schools. The Haskalah marked the downgrade of the use of Yiddish, the revival of Hebrew, and the adoption of European languages. At the end of the 17th century, wealthy Jews in Germany started to teach their language, German and French, to facilitate business and social contacts with non-Jews. And by 1790s, French had become the language of the Jewish elite, while German was the spoken language of businessmen and middle class. German writers had previously claimed that Jews deceived non-Jews by using Yiddish in business transactions, and thus a negative Yiddish attitude towards Yiddish developed. Mendelssohn thought that Yiddish was ridiculous, ungrammatical, and a sense of moral corruption. Some reformers called for the removal of Yiddish from Jewish schools, and other people suggested that Jews refrained from using Yiddish or even Hebrew in bookkeeping and business contracts. In the Netherlands, another country highly influenced by Haskalah, Jews gave up Yiddish in favor of Dutch. The Haskalah also led to the revival of Hebrew, particularly biblical Hebrew. Mendelssohn wrote a Hebrew commentary on the Bible called the Biur to accompany a German translation. It was the very first Hebrew publication of Haskalah. By the 1820s, the focus of Haskalah shifted to the Austrian Empire. A new journal, Bikirei Haitim, Fruits of the Times, was published annually in Vienna between 1921 and 1932. It included poetry, literature, biographies, and so forth. The first Hebrew journal devoted to modern Jewish scholarship was the Kerem Hemet, Vineyard of Delight. It was published in Vienna, Prague, and Berlin between 1833 and 1857. And also the emergence of Haskalah actually led to the emergence of the secular Jewish literature. The very first Jewish literature as literature, not a literary religious text, I would say, can be actually attributed to Hasidim, because Hasidim, of course, wrote it still as religious fiction, but the so-called tales of Rabbi Nachman of Bratslav that actually were not even written tales, but oral fairy tales, oral sermons, I would say, later written by his disciples, can be together with the writings, again, the oral stories later written by disciples by Baal Shem Tov. But still, this literature definitely cannot be secular, although it also cannot be fully religious. It was more like a folk fairy tale that on one hand derived from religious tradition, on the other hand, had many images and metaphors that more were the part of the folklore and fairy tale and oral folklore than religious literature. However, it was Haskalah that created a new form of Hebrew literature. First of all, in Haskalah, authors started to write Hebrew novels, but these novels were set, what is interesting, mostly in Palestine with Jews as heroines, but they also had like lovers, villains, ancient Jews as romantic lovers and brave warriors. But later, Haskalah starts to create literature in the language of the country, in Germany in German, in Russia, actually in Russian. Writers of the Haskalah bring new ideas for the Jews, that their affliction was not part of the internal design or a punishment for their sins, that Hasidism was not a paradise on earth, and so on. Mostly all of these writings were in Hebrew or in Russian for intellectuals. But later in the 19th century, the authors started to use Yiddish for the masses, because masses didn't read Russian, and even in Germany, masses didn't read German, and in Poland, masses didn't read Polish or German. And we'll talk more and more a little bit afterwards about this Yiddish writing, because surprisingly, it's two languages in Russian tradition, not Hebrew, but Russian and Yiddish, that actually created the literature of the Haskalah. The Hebrew writers eventually turned to Zionism and the Jewish aspiration for the national homeland. For example, Isaac Peretz. So the Haskalah reached Russia in the 1840s. In 1841, a Russian group called Sharei or Haskalah, Seekers of Light and Education, put on the first Hebrew literary periodical, Perkei Safon, Flowers of the North. One of the writers, Mordechai Ginsburg, wrote stories based on Jewish, general, and Russian history, adapted from non-Jewish sources. Many of the poets in this magazine wrote about secular subjects, and they actually wrote in Hebrew, in lyrical Hebrew. One another important thing, that by contrast with Hasidism, Haskalah was strongly anti-messianic, but also it was pretty nationalistic. Because on one hand, after emancipation, there was definitely a rise in assimilation and assimilation into Russian society. But for Russia, it was pretty difficult, because the only way for Jew to be fully adopted into Russian society was to convert to Christianity. And in this sense, it was different actually from Germany. And many Muslims in Germany therefore identified themselves expressively as Germans, but in Russia, Jews never identify themselves in Russia if they didn't convert. So Russian Haskalah definitely is much stronger nationalistic and pro-Zionist rather than pro-assimilation, by contrast again with Germany. In most of Western Europe, Haskalah ended with the large number of Jews assimilating. The struggle for emancipation awakened some doubts about the future of Jews in Europe, and eventually largely led, even in Germany at the end of the 19th, the beginning of 20th century, to Zionism. Although not in such numbers as in Russia, where mostly Haskalah was ended firstly by pretty strong anti-Semitism and pogroms of the beginning of the 20th century, immigration to America, and actually a lot of people turned either to Jewish nationalism or later even to Jewish socialism, which had very strong actually at the beginning fight with Haskalah, because Haskalah was pro-Zionistic, while Jewish socialists, the followers of Bund, were actually pretty pro-Yiddish. But eventually the followers of Haskalah created the form of Zionist movement Hibatzion, and later Poalitzion, and the followers of Yiddish and the followers of the masses created Bund. So what I want now to talk about, I want to show you some examples how all this can be seen in practical form, firstly in art and then in literature. And we'll start talking about arts. So, well, this is Moses Mendelssohn, yeah, and this is the picture of Moses Mendelssohn, you know, you can just look and appreciate. But what I want to talk about, firstly, we'll talk about Western Europe, because we cannot speak about Haskalah in Russia without Western Europe. And I want to show you a few painters, mostly German, which were the most famous painters of the Haskalah period. So this is Maurice Daniel Oppenheim. And if we look at this picture shows a Jewish family somewhere in Germany, if you can see from the window. What is very important? Number one, the family is definitely well off. It's certainly not a shtetl family, it's a big city family, and you can see it, you know, with the clothes. What is also important, you can see that the girls are reading a book, and most probably they are not reading religious book, while the boy, you know, who studies sitting at the religious book, probably, you know, with the help of his father, is not again separated by girls, you know, they're all together. The furniture is pretty rich. The girls don't look like religious girls, they look very much like traditional German girls of their age. And this is what is like really important in this whole picture of Haskalah, because first of all, they try to show everyday life of Jews, but everyday life of, well, of Jews, everyday life of educated Jews, and I want to say like middle class, probably like rich Jews. So this is the same picture, a little bit bigger. This is called the Day of Atonement, yeah, Yom Kippur, and you can see the prayer in Yom Kippur. Again, this synagogue looks very different from the synagogues in Shtetl. And you can see on one hand the interest of the painter towards Jewish subjects. On the other hand, it's done really in very, I would say, European beauty. You can look at the chandelier, you can look at the white clothes. It very much, in a way, again, some kind of ancient, in my opinion, Jewish tradition, which is extremely important. And also what is important, painters like Oppenheimer started to picture, to make these pictures, not for Jewish, but for Western audiences, really to introduce non-Jews to the life of Jewish tradition and to make thus the communication between Jews and non-Jews probably easier, so that Gentiles are able to see what really happens inside the Jewish synagogue on high holidays and to see it like in a beautiful way. On the other hand, Oppenheimer and the authors and other painters of his time wanted to show the life of simple Jews as well. But they did it very much in the same time, in the same sense, in the same folk tradition as Brothers Grimm and romantics of the early 19th century portrayed the German fairy tales. They really wanted to show some kind of the cuteness, you know, folk life, and to make it like a little bit picturesque, but also to do it in the European fashion, in the fashion of like realistic painting that portrays emotions and so on. So this is the shtetl, this is the teacher, and you see here are the children who are learning, and each of them has their own face. And here is the teacher who has also some kind of, you know, attentiveness and face and so on, and very much attentiveness to details, like I would even say in the old Dutch masters in the classical European school of 17th century. The other author about the painter about whom I want to speak is Isidor Kaufmann. And Isidor Kaufmann actually is younger definitely than Oppenheimer, and he very much tried to show the life of the shtetl. He wrote not so much in the manner of the earlier painters, but in the tradition of the mid-19th century, which in Russia actually is very much known as передвижники, wanderers, where the whole idea of the painter was to show social criticism in a way, the real life of social masses. So Isidore Kaufmann painted shtetl, painted shtetl Jews, and you can see how different is this world from the world of, well, of upper middle class German Jews that you just saw. And what is important here, again, you can see these facial features, but on the other hand, it's very much a social commentary. You can see the poor room, you can see the communication in some kind of social, you know, way. Notice that there are no women sitting at the table, it's a shtetl. There is only a woman who serves food. But again, he tries to show in a way like some kind of crampy conditions, you know, of the shtetl apartments, and show how, you know, probably Jews are sitting, studying, or doing business or whatever. And try again to show them to general non-Jewish public. And again, this is Kaufmann. You can see it's interesting that in a way, Isidore Kaufmann and his painting of Jews very similar, in my opinion, to Shalom Aleichem as author. Because, for example, you know, if we go back, just if you look at this picture, yeah, and you look at these faces really don't look too way Jewish to me. They look pretty much German, I would say, yeah, very like assimilated. But here, if you look at these faces, it's very much the type of Jewish face that later we can see, I don't know, in the musical Tevye the Dairyman, this image of the shtetl Jew that becomes popularized in late 19th century. And then after Holocaust, with like large immigration from Russia, the break of the traditional shtetl becomes very much its symbol. You know, if you look at this face and in this smile, it's very similar to how you would imagine the shtetl Jew. And same thing here, you know, it's all Isidore Kaufmann, same thing here, you know, this like smiling, in a way, I would say a little bit like, what's the English word? I don't want to say dishonest, but you know, so again, very Jewish, Jews, you know, some, I don't know, Jews telling anecdotes, doing probably business. Traditional shtetl image that later became very much the symbol of the folklore, and the symbol that later will commemorate in Tevye the Dairyman. And again, it's interesting that if we go back here, if you look at this picture, the main color is white. Yes, it's the Day of Advent, of course, everything is in white, but you see the grandeur, you know, with this white, everything, light is white, colors are white, even the table is white, and the tefillah, you know, the talis are white. But if we go here, there is very little white, there is a lot of black, and again, because it's an everyday Jewish costume, but you can see how everything is very poor, and there are like these glasses, and the floor is dirty, and there is nothing on the walls, again, you know, by contrast with this picture, you know, where you have wallpaper, and everything is ornamented, and here is like everything is simple, and the black color is the black and green what navigates it. So in a way, we can say that Kaufmann criticizes very much like Shalom Aleichem, criticizes the shtetl community. On the other hand, making it like very alive and lovable, I would even say. And this is, again, this is called the Jewish tailor, and the image of the Jewish tailor, again, so much becomes later important in the Jewish folkloric tradition. And I would even say that the images of a shtetl Jew that later are so much developed in Chagall and in Soutine, and especially in Chagall, in Jewish modernism, actually derive very much from the realistic images of Isidore Kaufmann. And again, here we are seeing More like a traditional kind of German painting, and again we can comparing them. This is called the Jewish Lady on Shabbat, and again compare the two. Here she has a rich dress. Here the everything is much more like elaborated, and the color is white. And the comparison between white and black and these two type of pictures, in my opinion, is very very important. You know, waiting for Kiddush. So, and this is already later, this is the end of the 19th century, and this is in an interesting way that you know, Kaufman started to depict more Jewish women, and it's interesting that when you look at this picture, you can see in a way this whole like feeling for emancipation, although the woman is praying, but you can see how the woman becomes the center of the picture. And this is also a very, very, very famous picture, which is called the Day of Adonment. And again, it's very important that it's much more was oriented towards non-Jewish audience than Jewish audience, to basically introduce the non-Jews to religious holidays. Again, Haskalah also starts the secular portrait, not just, you know, kind of mass portrait of people, although again, if you look at this picture, basically everyone has some kind of a face, but also secular portrait of Jews. And I want you to compare this too, because it's interesting again how to see the facial features in this like traditional type of realism and 19th century realism, to see the characters, see the real people. And it's also important to note that, if, as you know, in traditional Jewish arts, it's forbidden to paint people, because a man is done in the image of God, so you cannot paint people. So this very much goes against the traditional religious way, religious tradition, very much is a development of secular Jewish arts, I would put it that way. Again, you know, I want to show you some which were mostly developed during this time. The very last painter about whom to speak was also German, Maurice Gottlieb, and again, it's called The Prayer in the Synagogue. And what I like about it, that it's kind of comparing the two. So here, you know, somehow we have this, I would say, even like Renaissance type of faces, very much taken from the traditional Renaissance figure. But here, suddenly, we have much more realism. So the picture, in my opinion, very much, you know, designed in two ways, that it kind of breaks into two parts. That here is more high style, and here is more like lower style. And on the balcony, it's mostly women, as you know, and it's very interesting how this, like, women and children are done in much more realistic way, rather than this traditional, I would say, you know, I would like Renaissance type face of on the bottom. Here is also Maurice Gottlieb, and here it's even more interesting, because if you look at these people, you would never tell that they're Jews, especially this woman here that reads the letter. And this is, I want to kind of bring this to finish, that this is where really the Haskalah painting somehow got, because gradually the Jews that these people painted even didn't look like Jews. They looked like typical secular, probably, I don't know who this man is, businessman, lawyer probably, but definitely he doesn't look like religious Jew, but he is a Jew. And we know it because the painter was a Jew and he wanted, you know, to paint his Jewish subjects. And here it's also, it's a woman who is dressed in the best French fashion, reading probably a love letter, has really nothing to do with the Jewish religion, but we know that she is a Jewish lady. And that's very much, in my opinion, shows where really Haskalah got. And the next step in this will be the story of the Russian man, Isaac Levitan, because it's very funny to talk about Levitan as a Jew, because Levitan is known in Russia as probably the most famous painter of Russian nature and Russian soul in nature. But Isaac Levitan was a Jew. He went from a very small shtetl to St. Petersburg. He was accepted into Academy of Arts, but he understood that the only way for him to develop as a painter was to convert. So he converted, he became Christian, and joined the circle of wanderers, and became one of the most famous wanderers and the painter of Russian nature. And this is, in my opinion, like very funny picture, because I would say funny, but like ridiculous, because it's a very, very famous Russian picture, which is called Above the Final Rest. Yeah. And it shows a very small Russian church. He liked to paint Russian churches, even like Russian skit churches, but Russian chapels. But it's a picture which was painted by a Jew. Levitan, by the end of his life, never actually could find the place, I would say, for his soul. How would it say, where does he belong? He never felt fully Russian. He definitely couldn't be Jew anymore because he converted. And he, till his very end of the life, never could belong anywhere. And he died relatively young, and he drank actually a lot. And as some people say, drank himself to death, and got sick and died. And it's a pretty sad story, because in a way, this is how Haskalah worked in Russia, by contrast with Europe. Because, and again, this is also Levitan, you know, you can see these beautiful churches in one of the provincial town, painted by a shtetl Jew, who never ever still was accepted into society, even after he converted, because he was a Jew. So now what I want to talk about, I want to stop sharing. I want to talk briefly about literature, because when we spoke about art, now it's time to talk a little bit about literary subjects, but that will be probably a different lecture, but we'll just touch upon. Russian literature of Haskalah developed surprisingly into two ways. It actually developed into third way, the Hebrew way, but it wasn't that popular, and I'm not going to talk about it. What I want to talk about it is firstly the literature that developed in Kiev mostly, and it was represented by two literary people, firstly by parents, and by the author who can be considered probably the very first Russian Jewish secular writer, Menachem Mendel Mohersfori. He decided to take a nickname, pen name, Mohersfori, which is the seller of the books. And he was basically known very much just as like Mendel Mohersfori. And he started to write in Yiddish. And why he started to write in Yiddish was because he believed that his literature needs to educate the masses, that the masses need to be re-educated back from values of Hasidism into reason and into secular subjects. And in one, for example, of his short stories, his main character gets drunk. And when he gets drunk, he has this Hasidic mystical meditation, which is so popular in Hasidism. He gets to heaven, just as in Hasidic tales, they tell you. And when he gets there, he learns that God wants to kick him out because they don't accept Jews there in heaven. And he gets kicked out and wakes up. And he mocked very much in his writing the Hasidic ideas and the Hasidic stories, and constantly made parodies of them. But of course, the most famous Haskalah writer in Russia, surprisingly later, also became probably even against his will, because of the historical development that happened in the Eastern Europe, he actually became the symbol, in a way, of shtetl Yiddish and the symbol of shtetl life. Although in his writings, he very much criticized that life and very much showed that it comes to the end, because it cannot exist in the world which is torn apart by pogroms, by anti-Semitism, by the developing evolutionary movements, and by capitalism entering Russia. And this is Sholem Aleichem. We probably will talk about Sholem Aleichem in a separate lecture. It's a right, like, you know, very interesting subject. And if I have time, I want to actually make a lecture about three so-called most famous family stories in Russian Jewish literature. But what is important that in Sholem Aleichem's household in Kyiv, people didn't speak Yiddish. They spoke only Russian. All of them were extremely well educated. His daughters were extremely well educated. They all went to Russian school, and Russian was the language of their house. However, Sholem Aleichem wrote only in Yiddish because he believed that he needs to write in Yiddish to educate the masses. On the other hand, the Kiev Jews, and in order to settle in a large city in Russia, outside of the shtetl, but still in the pale of settlement, you have to be pretty rich. Otherwise, you wouldn't get the permission. So mostly these were the people who were very successful merchants or businessmen. And their children are adapted to the Haskalah, but they became very strong Zionists, especially because they saw the situation in Russia, they saw the horrible Kishinev pogroms, they saw Kiev pogroms. So that was the young generation that actually in 1890s and the early 20th century decided to leave Russia to Palestine, and with the help of their fathers, they collected the money to organize the Zionist movement, the Zionist meeting, to send chalutzim abroad. And this somehow discrepancy, I would say, you know, this disbalance where on one hand, the person who wrote in Yiddish and who is probably the most famous Russian Yiddish writer, in his household fully spoke Russian and was very much assimilated into Russian life, is, in my opinion, the most famous example of the Russian Jewish Haskalah intellectual. And the second thing that I want to speak about briefly, but again, that's the topic of the separate lecture, is the city of Odessa. Because in the early 19th century, actually already in the late 18th century, a small village relatively close to, you know, not close to Turkish border, but in the south of Russia, starts to grow more and more into a port city. And this port city was still in the Pale of Settlement, but firstly Catherine and then Alexander wanted to build this as, in a way, like a cosmopolitan city, a city which would be a southern port post for Russia. And it allowed people who wanted to settle in Odessa got some kind of promotions and monetary help and so on. So it became very much like a haven for many Jews. And also it was a city where Greeks and Jews and Russians and Ukrainians actually in the beginning lived pretty happily together till 1880s, when like the very first clashes started and the pogrom started, and then it was 1905, and it was a horrible pogrom of 1905, and all these hopes actually ended. But because of this atmosphere of the open city, it was Odessa that became the center of Haskalah in Russia. It was Odessa where the first Haskalah magazine, as I said earlier, was created, but also it became a birthplace of Russian Jewish literature in Russian, which later developed into very many interesting, I would say, branches, because one of them is an extremely wonderful but completely forgotten novel by the man who wrote it under his real name, Vladimir Zhabotinsky, but whom we know as Zeev Zhabotinsky, who later became one of the most fearful Zionists in Palestine. And he wrote a novel about his life, his youth, I would say, in Odessa, very much under the influence of Russification and Haskalah and where it led him. But on the other hand, it started to create the generation of young writers who wrote in Russian and who later basically were developing and, I would say, promoted after the Bolshevik Revolution, and they decided to join the Bolshevik Revolution and Became pretty successful in earlier years of the Bolshevik Revolution. Some of them were later killed and executed, like Babil. Some of them died by themselves pretty young, as Magnitsky. But some of them, as Kataev, lived pretty happily long life and became actually Russian writers who wrote in Russian and who probably didn't have anything already with being Jewish, except for their, you know, date of birth and place of birth and what in Russian was called nationality, but we can say minority. But if you ask them what type of writer you are, they would definitely say that they are Russian writers. So that's mostly it. And I hope that it will serve as a brief introduction of what Haskalah was and what the art and literature of Haskalah was in Europe and in Russian Empire. And I hope that we will continue with introduction, this introduction later with more precise works, particularly with the analysis of free Russian novels by Zhabotinsky, by Sholem Aleichem, and also later by Moishe Kulbok. And we'll see how the Russian Jewish writer, Yiddish Jewish writer, and Zionist Russian Jewish writer developed nearly in the same time. Thank you. And